Okay, so normally I don't find it all that daunting to speak, but today I'm a little nervous because I've known Elizabeth a long time, and normally I don't care, but today I somehow care that I don't want to let her down. You know, I am a little nervous. But one thing I will say that Elizabeth and I have done a lot of disruption together. It's basically something we found ourselves thrust into because the situations we got into required some, you know, pushing and nudging and stuff like that. I didn't realize that over the years it became a professional qualification. So I'm very honored to be a disruptor. Now, when Elizabeth asked me, you know, I was beginning to think I have no good ideas because they wouldn't invite me. And then Elizabeth met with me and she's like, you know, you should come and talk about disruption. You do it pretty well. I'm like, oh, okay. So I thought I was going to come and talk about something unique. And then I realized that, of course, the private sector has already clued into this. And as with all things coming from that sector, seems to have turned it into something quite esoteric and cutting-edge thinking that leads to innovation and competitive edge and all that. So, of course, as usual, I thought I was being novel, but nah, that is not the case. So I was looking at what the private sector talks about, and I came across a blog which very triumphantly states, and I quote, it's a rather long quote, I'll read it quickly. Disruptive questions enable us to cultivate fresh perspectives and insights about what currently is and what could or might be in the future. They fearlessly puncture in the box thinking to uncover counterintuitive and surprising solutions. They are invitations to think differently about a person, situation, decision, challenge, or problem. They are also key creative catalysts that allow, provoke, and emerge possibilities for innovative ideas, decisions, and solutions that may or may not have previously existed. Don't you just feel positively aglow with possibilities now? Yeah, that's how I felt. But you know what? There is some truth to this definition. Being disruptive per se can be a desirable goal, since it allows for alternatives and even innovation to flourish. But for me, the difference is, what is the purpose? Why are you being disruptive? I mean, get a life, do something. Like, you know, why would you want to be disruptive? So from my perspective, in an increasingly complex society, disruptive thinking is actually an essential tool in your analytical toolbox. But society is not just complex, it is also stratified, where there seems to be a remarkable persistence of inequality and inequity. And this is both material, as in living conditions, access to opportunities, stress, etc., but also, and I think this is important, and Elizabeth will laugh at me that I use these terminologies, epistemic, which means production of knowledge. I think it is important to recognize that it's not just people are marginalized because they don't earn enough or they don't have opportunities or they are, you know, poor or whatever. They also do not have access to production of knowledge. And I think both of these things go hand in hand. Hence, for the purpose of achieving social justice, if we want to interrupt the conventional narrative in society and strive to unearth and even possibly, you know, produce an alternative equity-based material discourse, then we need to be disruptive, not just as a strategy I would submit to you, but as a moral imperative. I don't think you have a choice in this, man. So if you were thinking, oh, I'm going to go back and being, you know, what I used to be, I'm never going to disrupt anything, you're going to have to do that if you want to create an equitable and just society. Business as usual, based in conventional wisdom, will not cut it, since in my estimation, it is neither conventional nor indeed wise. It is usually a general, what is conventional wisdom? It's usually a generally known and agreed upon fact that is universally assumed to be true, but only by those who have the power and privilege to universalize it, not by everybody else. In my experience, this tends to entrench complacency, perpetuate historic inequality, and silences those at the margin as being special interest, unless someone actively and consciously disrupts and unsettles that comfort zone. Hence, as an activist, being a disruptive force is not a choice for me. It is inherently essential to bring about meaningful change. The fact that I also enjoy it and thrive in it, well, that's just bonus, right? Now, to be an effective disruptor, you really need to ask disruptive questions. And this is something I learned from my lawyer spouse, and believe me, I try to minimize my learning from him, but who says that the secret to being a good trial lawyer is to ask the right questions so that the answer necessarily leads to a positive outcome. Of course, in his case, he's talking about a positive outcome for his client. But there is some truth to this, and believe me, it takes a lot for me to say that what he's saying has some truth to it. In my experience, using disruptive questions that lead to a positive outcome is to challenge the silence in popular discourse, to rupture the status quo, to disrupt the self-perpetuation of privilege so that those who have been silenced can be heard, and if one were really optimistic, possibly even become the architects of their own history and future. Now, I know this sounds like a tall task. Sounds good, though. So, what are the five essential questions that I think would lead to necessarily positive outcomes but are being disruptive in the process? Whose narrative is it anyway? Who benefits from it? Who is silenced by this narrative? What would the narrative look like if the silence was voiced? And would this lead to any material change in society? Now, both in my NGO life and now as a bureaucrat, I find that I rely more and more on what I call my gut discomfort to get to those disruptive questions. When I'm in a meeting or conference or reading something and I just know that something is missing, something is not quite right, I start looking for what is not being said, what ought to be said. Now, I grant you, this is not the most scientific way to do your business, but hey, you know, the art of living is never explained by science. Before I get into my five disruptive questions, I just wanted to explain my choice of resources. And I don't know if you had a chance to look at my resources, but if you look at them, you'll realize that there is some method to that madness. I chose them for three very good reasons. One, I chose them because those are the types of eclectic things that interest me and I learn most from. I wanted to put my children's name on it, but then I thought, because they are the real teachers as far as I'm concerned. But I thought, nah, you don't want to go there. There's nothing but grief there, because they actually believe in irreverence and shock therapy. So I'm a survivor, but you don't need to suffer that. So I didn't put their name. Secondly, I chose them to show that disruptive thinking that aims to produce socially equitable and just outcome is not limited to a particular discipline or a particular activity. We can all be disruptive in whatever we choose to do or wherever we find ourselves. That is why the resources range from a novelist's TED Talk to a rap song, to a policy research paper, to a documentary, to a spoken word narrative, to a practitioner's experience. Because everywhere, there is no domain where you get to do disruption, man. You don't get to go to your university and learn to be disruptive. Oh, no. The day universities start disrupting, remind me to go back. But lastly, but most importantly, I chose them because I wanted to disrupt the very notion of knowledge. Hip-hop lyrics are as much knowledge as an article in Harvard Law Review. And that is the point of disruption. It happens at every turn. It can happen at every moment. It just depends on how you look at it and why you are doing it. So disruption is not just something you do to others. It is pretty much the way you are. So diverse though these sources may be, they all have two things in common. One, they are all seeking to challenge a particular prevailing narrative by offering an alternative way of looking at it, but one that is based in untold historical and current facts. I mean facts that are not mentioned, are not always obvious, that are not articulated or voiced. Now, I warn you, I'm not talking about post-truth, which in this trumped-up environment has now become an accepted Oxford Dictionary term. Do you know that? You didn't know that, right? See, you learned one thing new. And you know how it is defined? And I quote, relating to or denoting circumstances in which objective facts are less influential in shaping public opinion than appeals to emotion and personal belief. Now, I submit to you that's a rather sanitized version of saying it. I could have said it very differently. In fact, all these resources that I have chosen for you are doing just the opposite. They're not ignoring facts, but rather shining a light on the dark side of the objective facts. Not dark as in dangerous, but dark as in not being seen. A side that is often ignored, often obfuscated, denied legitimacy, and minoritized. By that I mean reduced to special interest, minority views, as opposed to what a hip-hop song says, tell the truth, homie. So, secondly, the reason I chose these resources, their aim is being disruptive. Their aim in being disruptive is not to be contrary for the sake of being contrary, but to actively disrupt the prevailing norm and consciously produce a more equitable and just outcome by reversing the flow of what parades as knowledge. And this is being done not to be hip, but to be just. In other words, there is intentionality to it, which in itself is a disruption of prevailing norm. Which, have you noticed how prevailing norm always appears to, it shows its own biases as if somehow they are unintentional and accidental? Well, there's nothing unintentional and accidental about it. And that's what these resources are trying to show. Now, I warn you, I'm a storyteller. So I'm going to tell you stories about the five questions and talk about them from my personal experience of migration, raising children, which, by the way, is a story in its own right, working in the social service sector, and now working for the government. So let's start with the first question. Whose narrative is it anyway? Well, this began to me when my children started going to school, and one day they came and they said they had to, they were celebrating Columbus Day. And I'm like, Columbus Day? Okay. And then the teacher called and she said she needed to talk to me because my daughter, who was in grade one, was being disrespectful. So I went to find out why my grade one daughter was being so disrespectful. And apparently she had told the teacher that her mom didn't believe in Columbus and didn't wish to celebrate him. The teacher, of course, she used some colorful words which I must have used. I don't remember. I think she could have said it differently. But she was in grade one, so she pretty much soaked up everything. So needless to say, the teacher was very upset and said, you know, you are doing something really terrible. And I thought to myself, I'm like, Columbus Day celebration, what is this? Whose narrative is this? Sounds like a settler narrative full of pioneering stories, founding themes. Like, for example, I didn't know that North America was lost, but apparently it was. You know, conceptualization of land and scape as empty, terra nullius. And therefore, it was ripe for settlement. Ooh, okay. In that case, probably my daughter was wrong. So that's Columbus Day narrative. Next thing I know, my son comes back from school and says his teacher wants him to do an immigration project to find out why his parents came to Canada. So he wanted to know if we were persecuted or economically disadvantaged. And I'm like, okay, where the hell is he getting this from? And I realized he must have gotten direction that the immigration discourse is a savior narrative. You know, give me your huddled masses and they will come and we will save them. So I told him, I said, I don't know, man, me and your dad were getting bored. So we thought, you know, let's go and check out the frozen tundra. So that's why we came here. And he's like, Ma, no, that's not what my teacher wants to know. I'm like, it doesn't matter, just tell her that. Now, at the time, I didn't know I was being disruptive. Next thing I know, my child is in grade 4 or 5 or whatever, and he is being asked to do a project on Middle Ages, medieval times. And I'm like, well, does she want you to do a project on 5th to 15th century, or does she want you to do a project on medieval times? And he goes, no, medieval times, man, 5th to 15th century, that's what it is. And I realize he's seeing it as a universal point of reference that marks the Dark Ages, which fall between the fall of the Roman Empire and the Age of Discovery. And that's what he means by medieval times. So I'm like, okay, I get that. I'll tell you what I did about that too. Then one night, I'm sitting there reading a book. Sometimes I did that when my kids were small. And I'm reading Narnia to my daughter. And halfway through I stop and she's like, no, please don't do that. Don't come up with some political explanation. She's like, when you stop, I know you're going to do something nasty like that. But you know, I had to stop, man. I had to stop. Think about it. What I was still reading to my daughter, it was speaking about a world where people are, that particular book, the people were dark skinned, were wearing what sounded suspiciously like turbans and pointed shoes, forcing their daughters into marriage, and wanted to harm Narnia. And what was Narnia? A white space, a happy place where animals talked, rulers were called Peter and Edmund and Susie and Lucy. So where is my daughter in this, man? I wanted to know, where is my daughter in this? Okay, I told her, you're not going to read this until you understand this point. Then one day I'm working in the NGO sector, I'm invited to speak on Person's Day anniversary. Now you know what a person's day is, right? 1927, Supreme Court of Canada says women are not persons. they wish. And so, denied political participation. You know the famous five who then go to the Privy Council of Great Britain and get the decision reversed in 1929, which opens up the door to franchise for women. Now, what is this? It is ostensibly a Canadian women's narrative. But is it? Is it really? Think about it. So then the next question arises, if that is the narrative, who benefits from it? To my mind, to my simple understanding of it, those who already have privilege in society benefit from it. If we do not disrupt intentionally, then changing society either becomes an issue of good intentions or accidental. And it may or may not benefit those who are most vulnerable. So think about this. We build a building, and then suddenly we decide, oh God, it's not accessible, man. Oh, put a ramp. Afterthought, right? So you put a ramp. Now the mobility device can go up to the front door, but the door doesn't open. The corridors are too narrow. The elevator is not accessible. The washrooms are not accessible. See what I'm saying? Maybe they benefit and maybe they don't. Because, you know, we don't think about that. We don't think about, and those who are privileged are no less privileged. They continue to be privileged. But those who are not privileged don't necessarily get privileged because of it, right? This is an afterthought. So then the question arises, who is silenced by all these narratives? Think about it. Columbus Day. I think indigenous narrative is silenced. I don't know about you, but you know, if the land is empty except for the indigenous people who lived there, may look empty to you, it doesn't look empty to them. May have been lost to you, wasn't lost to them. Person's Day. Who does it silence? It silences African-Canadian women, ethno-racial women, indigenous women. Narnia, fascinating. Narnia does something quite interesting. It both creates the racial other and simultaneously silences it. So my child doesn't have the sophistication. Now she does, oh my God, now she can deconstruct you in a heartbeat. But at that time she couldn't. Something else I come across, for example, in the work that I do now, is the universalism that is embedded in public policy. It's based on, I think, on an erroneous assumption of equality. To me, in a highly unequal and stratified society, if you create policy in a universal framework and do not address inequality, then all you do is you silence those who are marginalized, right? So what would you do if the narrative were such that the silence was actually voiced? Now that's the fun part of it. Now, if we were actually teaching history where we specify that Aboriginal people are not fossilized remnants of forgotten history, but actually contemporary people trying to fight for their right to self-determination, to have control over their land, their communities, their history in Canada, then Columbus would not be an adventurer. He would be a mercenary who came looking for riches for rulers of Europe. We would say that he got lost, thought he found India, and brought mass death and destruction to indigenous peoples. If you don't do that, then my Indian child will end up celebrating another Indian's demise. I can't let that happen, man. I can't let that happen. Okay? Think about it. When we talk about Person's Day and history of women's franchise in Canada, We will mention that 1929, only some of the women got the voting rights. Poor women could not vote because property rights were tied to franchise. African Canadian women could not vote because they didn't have, because of discrimination. Asian women were not even given the right till 1947-48. And indigenous women did not get the right till 1961. So, if we want to build a women's solidarity narrative, then we must articulate women's privilege, but also their struggles and inequality. I always try to remind, there's a writer, Chandra Mohanty, British writer, who wrote in a book once that beyond sisterhood, there's still colonialism and racism. So we can't just talk about sisterhood and not talk about those sisters who don't have the same privileges as others, right? I'm not denying sisterhood, man. I'm all for it. But let's get real here. Let's talk about, and that's one of the reasons why all solidarity movements have a tendency to fall apart, because we don't address the inherent inequalities. And we want, and guess, for the sake of fighting the gender war, maybe not war, but gender struggle for equal rights, etc., we say to everybody, settle down. I remember, it reminds me, when I was at Sussex University, all my communist friends, South Asian friends, used to say to me, Uzma, just, you know, let the revolution come and then we'll talk about gender equality. And I'm like, hey, I'm not waiting for your revolution. I want it now. Because while you're planning your revolution, you want me to cook the food for you. Hell no, I'm not gonna cook the food for you. I want to talk about my equality now. And they all thought, oh, I'm being so bourgeois. You know, we were young and silly in those days. For example, when we would be reading C.S. Lewis, it would be nice to show his books are based on a highly charged racial subtext where my racialized child is actually an outsider to Narnia. Now, that would help to disrupt my child's subliminal marginality, because subliminally, she's reading this book without realizing that she's actually marginal to Narnia. That's a desired space she wishes to be in, but her historical and her cultural space is outside of Narnia. That's what's called subliminal messaging. If we were to adopt, for example, an equity lens to policy making, say a gender lens, it would yield very different results. For example, something like TTC would not just be about trains and buses running on time, although don't misunderstand me, I wish they would. No, don't get me wrong. I do. Somehow, make them run. They would not be about just running on time and infrastructure, but if you have a gender lens to policy, you would also look at issues of safety, accessibility, affordability. When you're talking about employment and equal opportunity to employment, and you have a gender lens to it, it wouldn't just talk about jobs being accessible, but it would be about childcare, affordable and accessible transport, inclusive hiring practices, etc., without which women will continue to be systemically excluded. And I haven't even put another layer to it. What you would also need to do then is use the gender lens to pay attention to differential experiences of women. For example, indigenous women, immigrant women, racialized women, trans women, women with disabilities, they have their own particular trajectories that also need to be paid attention to. So just because we are creating, so not only is policy making should not be in this generic universal frame, but even the lens that you apply to it must be more nuanced, because that's how you disrupt the hegemony of that universality. And here I have a suggestion, believe me. I mean, I'm not just here criticizing shit. Criticizing stuff. You did tell me to mind my language, yes. Here I have a suggestion. And I learned this from my colleagues in the United States, which I think they will need more now than I do. It's called targeted universalism. And it's an interesting concept. What it says is, develop a solution to a social problem focusing on a specific group in a manner that will lead to maximum benefit to society as a whole. An example, I'll give you an example. Make addressing lack of accessibility a universal goal and develop accessible design guidelines to make sure that all public facilities are accessible by targeting the needs of those most likely to be marginalized in terms of physical access, which is people with disabilities. So you see what I'm saying? You have a universal goal in mind, but you're targeting your policy and practices towards addressing the particular needs of those who are most marginal and vulnerable in society. A fully accessible facility, for example, that makes access a priority for people with disabilities will also be accessible to seniors, mothers with small children, those suffering temporary disability or injury, kids, etc., as well as those who have never needed accommodation of access. It will not negatively impact those who don't need accommodation, but it would positively address those who are most likely. You see, you know how we say, oh yeah, you know, we make a policy for everybody. Some people fall through the cracks. Well, you know what? I don't know about you, man. Try falling through the crack. Not a very pleasant experience. You know, people make it sound like it's some generic thing. It's not. If you fall through the cracks, that means you are completely disappear from the narrative of public policy and its benefits and outcomes. You're nowhere. Nobody sees you. So let's not kid ourselves. Let's not use terminologies, oh, fell through the cracks, as if it's some, you know, wonderful thing. And we at the city actually have done this. We use this logic in our city's youth equity strategy by focusing on at-risk youth. Same logic. We think youth, school dropouts, unemployment, etc., is a major thing, right? We need to address that. But focused on at-risk youth so that we can extrapolate the benefits to youth at large. It's not going to, you know, disadvantage them. It doesn't mean all our resources are just going into taking care of one child. It means putting in programming that would help more broader community, but particularly will not leave out at-risk youth. In the report, when they said that we are using this terminology, targeted universalism, one of the counselors turned around and said that was an oxymoron. I'm not so sure. I know it's hard for us to come to grips with it, but I think it's a concept worth considering. Similarly, when we would teach middle ages and the dark ages, we would need to specify that the references to Europe and not 5th to 15th century, because it was not the Dark Ages for other civilizations. And contrary to popular belief, yes, there were other civilizations, and there are other civilizations. I know we all think it all begins and ends here, but it doesn't. Disrupt the narrative that European history is universal history. I had to tell my son to get this point clarified, since 10th to 15th century was the flowering of the Muslim civilization. He's like, no, please don't, no, she's going, no, I can't do that, you know, you make my life so difficult. I'm like, no. Go and ask your teacher. Does she want you to do a project on 5th to 15th century, in which case you're going to talk about the height of Muslim civilization? We may be in dark ages now, but we weren't then. Or are you going to talk about European history and medieval times? To his credit, kicking and screaming, he went. And he asked, and she specified that she wanted European history. But you know what? If the teacher wanted to be disruptive, you know what she would have done, which she didn't do? She would have said, well, you know that big mouth mother of yours? Why don't you ask her to come in the class and talk about the Muslim civilization? Because what she would have done then is shown her immigrant students that they too are part of the unfolding of the story of civilization and not just the perpetrators of a clash between civilizations. A huge point. Again, I insist, these are not small things. When my child sees reinforcement that he also belongs to a people who have done something significant in life, it just helps with self-esteem and things like that, you know. You don't need to be a psychologist for that. You just need to be a mother, and a disruptive mother, to think like that. It's not that I'm always looking for a fight, but I do end up there somehow. So it would be good, for example, when we are teaching our children math and science, not to just present them as array of numbers and concepts, but disciplines that have a history, where, for example, Hindu and Muslim mathematicians and scientists have made critical contributions to what we know today as commonplace. For example, Srinivasan Ramanujan, they have a movie about him now, who contributed to the analytical theory of numbers, elliptical functions, continued fractions, and infinity. And I don't even understand half of these things. Or Ibn Sina, he's known as Avicenna in the West. He was known in the West as the Prince of Physicians. His synthesis of Islamic medicine, called the Canon of Medicine, was the final authority on medical matters in Europe for several centuries. Did you know that? Yeah, that's what I'm saying. This is how you shine a light on the silences in the narrative. You need to bring it to the fore so people can actually see there is another side to it. Imagine if in this highly charged post-9/11 political environment, we showed that Muslims are not just in Europe creating a clash, but off Europe, and that their intellectual and cultural achievements over 8 centuries were the harbinger of European Renaissance. There is a video in my resource, watch it. But I give you an example here. My nephew, who had the misfortune of living with me for a while and hasn't recovered from it since, has 3 kids and he keeps telling them, stay away from Pupadadi. She's crazy, man, she's crazy. But really, he was in high school and he had to do a project where he was asked to talk about the roots of modern Europe. So I said, talk about the Moors. And he's like, excuse me? I'm like, talk about the Moors. That's where the roots of modern Europe are. Who the hell do you think was translating Greek philosophy and introducing it into Europe? It was the Muslims. What do you think they were doing for 800 years? Just sitting around? 800 years, not 1 year, 2 year, 3 year, 800 years. They must have done something. So I'm like, you know, if you want to talk about the roots of modern Europe, I hate to tell you, it comes through Muslims. And he did, to his credit. And his teacher, to his credit, said, interesting. Never thought about that. I don't know if he shared it with the rest of the class because that would have been a disruptive act. My son did the disruptive act by writing it, but the teacher would have done the disruptive act by sharing it and changing the mainstream narrative. Think about it. 800 years of Muslim European history is erased. And if it is, then we need to ask by whom and for why. What is the purpose of it? Because it's not silent to me. It would be good, for example, when we are teaching Shakespeare, to not just focus on iambic pentameter, but also anti-Semitism and sexism and racism, so that all those racialized kids in the class do not subconsciously somehow internalize their own marginality. It's bad enough that when you're colonized like we are for 200 years, I always say we come out of our mother's womb speaking English. That's the degree I did in Pakistan. Now, why the hell am I doing English literature in Pakistan and not Urdu literature? Don't know. Don't ask. But never talked about these things. We talked about iambic pentameter. I know all about iambic pentameter, man. Know nothing about, never deconstructed these inherently subversive themes that run under it. And I think it is important to do so. For example, it would be good when I'm invited into school systems, to talk about my knowledge, my degrees in English literature, international relations, international law, my community work, my public policy work at the city, and not, as I was asked to do, to talk about arranged marriages. I felt like a fiddler on the roof. And I'm like, some of you are too young to know what fiddler on the roof is. But some of you, I can see, are laughing because you know. Now, think about it. My lecture was very short. I said I had an arranged marriage I arranged it myself, thanks. That kind of ended it all. But you know what? If I was invited into the school system to actually talk about my knowledge and my skills and my experience, then my child who's sitting in the class would look at it and say, immigrant and racialized and refugee parents generally, but women particularly, are also repositories of knowledge and not just passive recipients of Canada's generous immigration system. It would break that perception that what my children call Desi mother, which is brown mother, which is a South Asian mother, that Desi mothers only worry about whether you've eaten your food or not and who you're dating, and you shouldn't be dating them. No, man, we do other things too. And it would have done that. But no, I was asked to come and talk about arranged marriages. Needless to say, I was never asked to come back again. Because they thought I wasted their time. It would be good, for example, when schools and teachers in the schools who have those difficult conversations with parents on topics like sexual orientation and gender violence, they contextualize these concepts as societal issues of homophobia and violence against women that cut across culture and communities, and not as culturalized discourses. It is in their culture, or now that you are in Canada, or even worse, it is our culture, that's why we oppress our women. As if Canadian society without immigrants and refugees is free of homophobia and violence against women. Really? Oh, I must have slept through the feminist revolution. Remind me, I didn't realize we are living in a feminist haven now. There is no homophobia, there is no violence against women, it's only us immigrant types who do it. No, let's contextualize this so that we can actually address the issues and actually offer worthwhile solutions to our young people who have to suffer the consequences of all this. For example, having said that, to me, that's how you disrupt the narrative, by articulating the silences. Does this lead to any material change in society? I don't know. I've endeavored to be disruptive for over 25 years. I hope something stuck. I do have a lot of young people who come to me and say, oh, you know what? That made a difference to me because I heard you speak. That's nice. The most powerful thing I ever heard was when a young woman came up to me, a South Asian Muslim woman, and said, I heard you speak, and I was in an abusive situation, and I left. And I took my children with me. I went back to school, and now I'm a counselor for women who are survivors of violence. That made me feel good. I don't say it's because I'm some fantastic person that I changed her life. It's her. She had the courage. She had the strength to do it. But I'm glad if I've played a small role in it. So, my last question. Would this lead to any material change in society? I want to tell you a story, as if I haven't told you enough. It's the story of a group called Alternative Planning Group. In 1998, I became the executive director of Council of Agencies Serving South Asians. Soon after I joined CASA, my counterpart from Hispanic Development Council and Chinese Canadian National Council Toronto chapter came to me and said, we should work together. I was new. I'm like, I have nothing else to do. Might as well work with you. Their point was that the city had just gotten amalgamated. Our communities lived all over the city. We were umbrella organizations whose mandate was social planning of our communities, but alone we did not have the capacity to influence the megacity's social planning agenda, but a collective of South Asian, Latin American, Chinese communities could be irresistible. So the three of us got together and decided to call ourselves something. So first we said we'll call ourselves the Ethno-Racial Planning Council. And then somebody said, nah, man. They'll just think we do, we are those special interest people who just do planning for ethno-racial types. We have nothing to teach the mainstream society. Now, we're going to call ourselves the Alternative Planning Group. Someone said, well, what are we alternative to? And we're like, everything. We are alternative to everything. You know, you got to dream big. So we called ourselves the Alternative Planning Group and decided to pool our minuscule resources to maximize the benefit. We used to call ourselves the three tenors. I was Placida Domingo. Dubelis from Hispanic Development Council of Pavarotti, and Rick from Chinese Canadian National Council Toronto chapter was Carrera. And it was not based on our singing abilities, but on our physical stature. We thought, you know, this is going to be fun and games. Now, the starting premise of APG was to recognize that our collective heritage was not a commonality of history or culture or race or language or even time of arrival, but rather our collective experience of marginality on one hand and commitment to equity and solidarity on the other. So we were very clear up front. We are not the same. We are different, proud to be different, but we choose to work together, right? Big difference. This is no hegemonic solidarity. This is solidarity based on our difference. Our strength was, in fact, to acknowledge our difference as the starting point of negotiating a shared common agenda and common good. But most importantly, we grew organically and literally. And I say organic, it means we had no plans, man. We just did it. So first we used to meet occasionally, you know, talk about what we can do together. Then we started having monthly APG directors meetings, keeping minutes and things. Then we started to identify each other's strengths so that each one could deal with one issue for all. You know, it's like the three musketeer model, one for all and all for one. Because none of us had enough resources to do all the things all the time. So we said, okay, HDC, which is the Hispanic Development Council, will provide research and state data for everyone. Chinese Canadian National Council will provide media advocacy and community organizing. And CASA, my organization, will focus on organizing and advocating on the issue of immigrant and refugee access to professions and trades, and that's where Elizabeth comes in. Next thing we did was to organize a joint board meeting of all three councils. Now imagine this. Think about it. We are in this Chinese restaurant. Oh, that was another thing. We had to have our dinners at different restaurants every time. Very important, you know, when you, equity is equity, man. So sometimes it's South Asian restaurant, sometimes Chinese, sometimes it's Latin American. You gotta be equal. So, and why not eat? Because if you eat together, you probably stay together. So when we had this joint board meeting, it was a rather large and raucous group, which eventually turned into an annual event where all board members got together, not just to eat food and sing the international in different languages, but to actually set annual priorities for the partnership. Think about it. Chinese, South Asian, and Latin American board members get together annually, talk about their community's issues, find common issues, and set the priority for the collective. Now, I don't know about you, I thought it was very exciting and unique. This led to the natural next step where we started to submit joint funding applications to do research on organizing or advocacy on the same issue for all communities. What made us unique was that we individually focused on our own communities, but then always came together to produce a synthesized report which was based on our collective wisdom and showed similarities and differences between our community issues. We used our collective as effectively as possible. For example, this used to be fun. Now that I'm City Hall, it really makes me laugh. City Hall allows deputations for up to 5 minutes. You know that, right? So what did we do? We would plan. If one of us had a compelling issue, we pooled our time together to give that community 15 minutes, while the other two would sit there silently in support. So visually, the Chinese council is talking about something for 15 minutes, and South Asians and Latin Americans are sitting there going, yep, yep. I don't know about you, that's a powerful visual. We were pretty large at that time as well, physically, I mean. So 15 minutes is a long, long time for a deputation. You can say a lot. But if we wanted to reinforce a common issue, we would take our 5 minutes one after the other, made sure we were right one after the other, and say the same thing over and over and over again. This is what the Chinese community thinks. This is what the South Asian community thinks. This is what the Latin American, but they say the same thing. Just to reinforce the point of view that these marginalized communities have a common agenda and a shared purpose. It was fun, and it started to make a difference. People started to notice. I was asked to speak, for example, at a conference where continental African groups were getting together to see if they can form a collective umbrella organization. I spoke about my experience of working within the South Asian community. I don't know about you, but it's a notoriously fragmented group. Like, I had to come all the way to Canada to meet an Indian. Really, like, they live right next door. But we are so busy fighting with each other that you have to go to some third place before we can get to know each other. Here, I spend all my time bending over backwards to make sure Indians are there, Sri Lankans are there, You know, so it's an interesting thing. Like, Canada allowed us the space to create a political identity called South Asianness. Not a physical identity, not a cultural identity, but it's a political identity. So I talked about that. And I talked about the fact that if they actually create an umbrella group, then there is APG, which will allow them a space to create a whole new partnership. Well, next thing you know, African Canadian Social Development Council was formed, and they became the natural partner of APG. So now we actually had the tenors and their conductor, Zubin Mehta. God, you guys really don't. I mean, like, how come I know all this Western stuff and you don't? Anyway, so since we all had our own individual portfolio that we managed for the collective, African Canadian Social Development Council identified their interest in focusing on community economic development strategies for all. So now we had increased our capacity by four and broadened the scope of our work. We were doing community organizing and advocacy. We had excellent data and research. We were advocating on access to professions and trades, and we were working on community economic development models. Doesn't that sound good? Come on, man, this is exciting stuff. I still get excited. Two examples that best illustrate our work and methodology were that we did a settlement needs assessment. We produced four reports. We are cumbersome as hell. Produced four reports on the four communities and then penned a joint fifth report that identified the common issues faced by all four communities. Funders were delighted. You know how funders are, and I know Maytree is a funder too. They get tired of all these piddly little groups running around saying, oh, listen to me. They want one thing, right? But they want to homogenize us. But we don't want to be homogenized, man. So it's better that we collectively organize, keeping our integrity, keeping our distinction, but also presenting a joint forum. So the funders were happy, and we were happy. We were not subsumed under a generic ethno-racial group. We felt, on the other hand, terribly emboldened because our collaborative was actually producing shared knowledge. Out of this emerged the understanding, for example, out of the settlement project, that all our seniors were facing similar issues. Lack of access to culturally competent services, inability to access government programs, since they all lacked that labor market attachment principle that underlines government assistance. These were all, after all, immigrants who came here as seniors. They didn't have that 10-year labor market attachment. When I become a senior, I already am there, I'll have a different trajectory from my mother-in-law. She couldn't bring her pension and her assets here. There is no relationship between Pakistani government and Canadian government where such a transfer can happen. I'll be done soon. I know her so well. She just one of those looks and I'm done. And out of this, so these were basically seniors who were socially, culturally, and linguistically isolated, but also had a structural, systemic problem in accessing government supports. And they shared it. So their language and culture may not be the same, but they shared this one systemic barrier. So guess what? We brought all the seniors together and created a seniors advocacy group. Oh, you got to see that, man. You had to see it. The seniors were amazing. They learned to build relationship with each other. They developed their shared advocacy platform and took action collectively. To us, the issue was not whether they succeeded or not. To us, the very process of collaboration was the product. The fact that four different community seniors could come together and actually work together on something that impacts all of them was the product, was the outcome. We also leverage, for example, HDC's youth program to develop similar programs in the South Asian community, Chinese community, continental Africa. And I know some of my funders are sitting here. My line to them was always, hey man, give it to us. HDC has it. I got to have it. Chinese community. And we're going to work together. We're going to work together. So funders were like, oh, okay, okay, we'll give you money. So they would give us money. And I remember our first fundraiser was organized by our youth. There was food from all four communities, performances from all four communities. And I looked at it and I thought, oh my God, we are essentially practicing our theory. This is great. Now we can theorize because we are actually living it. So that's when we started putting together our practice into theory. And let me tell you, people thought we were so full of ourselves. So, you know, who the hell do you think you are? We actually dared to say that we are the living example of what should happen in any pluralist, diverse, but unequal society like Toronto. And people looked at us and said, what arrogance, eh? I mean, what arrogance? But to me, that was the best, the most empowering moment of my life. But suddenly, while people were also telling us that we were arrogant, some people were garnering, it was garnering interest. Academics started writing PhD theses on us. Community groups were inviting us to share our learnings with them. And City began to acknowledge that we were a legitimate player in the field of social planning and gave us a grant as a collective and not as an individual. The first time we were invited to speak at a policy and research forum by the city, we thought we had died and gone to heaven. Today, the personalities have changed, but APG still exists. Perhaps it has lost some momentum, but the learnings are still very poignant. We disrupted the social planning narrative as being neutral and universal to saying, no, it has to be particular, it has to aim to address inequity in society, and it must make the subjects of planning owners of their own destiny. And in a diverse but highly unequal society, it must be transformative. Your end product cannot be planning for the sake of planning. It must be to transform the reality of people whose lives you happen to be planning. Our work focused on building capacity of vulnerable communities to work individually and collectively. It promoted sharing of resources to maximize our potential and impact, and showed that in an unequal society, planning is by necessity a political activity, but one that has to be equitable in its design, delivery, and outcome. That was our defining moment. Thank you very much.